Welcome back to Chemistry Matters Unit 9, our Kinetics and Gases Unit. We've been working on the development of our own airbag, based on the reaction between acetic acid and sodium bicarbonate. Have you determined the optimum conditions for your model airbag? Let's go back to our classroom so you can compare your experimental results to those of our students.
It looks like everyone's finished collecting and analyzing data for their model airbags. I saw a lot of inflated bags and heard a few bags explode too. I'm looking forward to hearing about your results. Who'd like to present their data first?
We will. We tested four different amounts of vinegar and baking soda. We started with 2 grams of baking soda and 30 milliliters of vinegar, because that's about how much we calculated we needed to fill the bag.
But then we remembered you saying that no reaction is 100% efficient. So we figured we'd probably need more than what we calculated.
So we increased the baking soda by 1 gram at a time. Our original plan was to increase baking soda 10% at a time, but we found that increasing by 1 gram at a time was much easier.
And we kept the ratio of vinegar and baking soda the same in each trial.
I like how you organized your data. It's easy to see what you did. What were your results and conclusions?
4 grams of baking soda and 60 milliliters of vinegar made the best model airbag. That's almost twice as much baking soda and vinegar as we calculated using stoichiometry.
Right. That's probably because of what we learned earlier about the reaction not being 100% efficient.
The bag inflated the fastest and was inflated so much that we thought it would burst, but it didn't.
Yeah, but when we used 5 grams of baking soda, the bag did burst open.
Can you explain why you think that more baking soda and vinegar caused the reaction to go more quickly? Try to use what we've learned from the collision theory and the kinetic molecular theory to support your answer.
Well, more reactants means more collisions, which means more carbon dioxide is made in the same amount of time.
So the rate of carbon dioxide production increases with more reactants.
Nice work, Dory and Colin. Let's see what the other team learned from their experiment.
We started with the same amounts, 2 grams of baking soda and 30 milliliters of vinegar. That didn't fill up our airbag either. But instead of increasing vinegar and baking soda at the same time, we only increased one variable at a time.
The combination that filled the bag completely and the fastest was 5 grams of baking soda and 40 milliliters of vinegar. If we used 6 grams of baking soda, the bag popped open.
Your results are pretty close to the other team's results. The amounts they found worked the best were 4 grams of baking soda and 60 grams of vinegar.
Whoa, that's a lot more vinegar than we used.
We kept an equal number of moles of the reactants. You used a lot more moles of baking soda than moles of vinegar.
That's a good observation of a key difference, Dory. Kayla and Bella had a limiting reactant in most of their trials. Can you explain what your reasoning was for doing that, Kayla and Bella?
We were trying to keep vinegar the limiting reactant so it would get used up and make a less of a mess.
Yeah, but towards the end, we realized that we needed to add a little more vinegar to get all the baking soda to dissolve.
That's a great idea to minimize leftover reactants. And in fact, that's the goal for an automobile airbag. I'm impressed that you kept practicality in mind. I also noticed that Kayla and Bella's times were shorter than Dory and Colin's times. Why do you think that may be?
We shook our bag while it reacted, which I think made it go faster.
That's a very good possibility, Bella. The rate of reaction is increased with increased agitation, as you know from the collision theory. Both teams have done an excellent job creating a model airbag. You can continue with more trials, of course, but notice that you've narrowed down the range of values for the reactants that make this size airbag work the best. You successfully optimized the reaction, and you recognize when the reaction has a limiting reactant. Well done.
That was a fascinating engineering design challenge. As you can imagine, there are a lot more constraints when developing an actual airbag for automobiles. Safety, speed, and cost are all important considerations. Some of you may want to continue exploring this engineering design challenge by identifying other environmentally friendly alternatives. In any case, I hope you've gotten an idea of the complexity that's involved in working with kinetics and gases. To that end, I had a chance to speak recently with someone who uses this knowledge in her job every day. And a pretty cool job it is. Lea Merriwether is a senior lab technician at the Georgia Aquarium, where she monitors water quality for all of the Georgia Aquarium's different habitats. Lea, thank you so much for joining us today on Chemistry Matters.
Thank you for having me.
Now, you're at the Georgia Aquarium. What do you do there?
I'm a senior water quality tech, and I am responsible for testing all the exhibit water from every system.
That's a big job. It's a big place. And how long have you been there?
I've been there about 9 years.
Wonderful. And the Georgia Aquarium, for those who haven't been, it's home to a whole lot of animals. There's a lot of fish and other animals there. And their natural habitats are very varied. Some of them come from seawater habitats. Some of them come from freshwater habitats. That's a lot of different habitats you all have to maintain. I imagine you use chemistry all the time.
Yes, we do. Here in Atlanta, the aquarium is a closed system, so we have to mimic the systems that these species are coming from, whether it be seawater or freshwater. So with the seawater, we use a product called Instant Ocean to get that, to create that ocean feel.
Nice. And you probably have to run a lot of tests for different materials. Tell us about some of the materials that you test for in the water on a daily basis.
We test for pH, salinity, ammonia, nitrite, copper, phosphate, iodine, alkalinity.
That's a lot to manage. How do you manage all that? How do you get those reports and know how to respond to them?
We keep a system of tracks, which is an animal record system. So for one system, it'll graph a readout of everything, all the pHs, all the salinities, all the ammonias, all the nitrites, all in one page.
It's a little like my medical records, but for the fish and their environment.
Correct.
Nice. And can you use then that information that you receive to compare to other readouts you've had in the past?
Oh, yeah. It can go back to at least 5 years.
Nice.
And based off of the daily numbers, the biologists will write up chemical additions.
And when you get those readouts, how do you respond if something needs to be tweaked in the system?
We have a set of guidelines, which are our parameters, and we can add sodium bicarbonate, sodium carbonate, ammonium chloride. We can add cold water bacteria, salt water bacteria, any number of chemicals we can add to get the parameters back into the right guidelines.
Sure. Now, is there ever an instance where you need to make a change quickly and you have to speed up or slow down the rate of reaction in a system?
Well, that depends on whether the system has animals or not. If it's something that doesn't have animals in it, we've had a system that had a high pH, so we added hydrochloric acid to lower that.
It makes sense. You would want to wait till the animals were out of that environment before you added the hydrochloric acid.
Correct.
That could be dangerous.
Yes.
Our students have just been learning about dissolved gases into solutions. What are some of the ways that you all maintain proper levels of dissolved gases in the different habitats?
We work closely with our life support team, and they give us a daily printout of the current oxygen and the current DO every day. They have inline probes that monitor the systems 24 hours a day.
And you say DO, just for those of us who aren't in the aquarium business.
That's dissolved oxygen.
Dissolved oxygen.
Yes.
Great. And when you get those readouts, how do you respond if the numbers aren't exactly where you want them to be?
If we need to increase the dissolved oxygen a little bit, we may increase the oxygen just a tad so the animals can relax a little bit more. So it'll cause the system to be supersaturated.
Supersaturation, we just covered that in our previous unit, so the students
awesome.
Should be familiar with that term.
Yay.
Now, tell us a little about your background. Obviously, you have a lot of knowledge of chemistry and animals and the different habitats. How did you end up here?
Actually, in high school, I had no interest at all with chemistry.
Really?
So college, it kind of grew on me. I'm an animal science major, so I took a lot of math, a lot of chemistry, a lot of biology. So it was just something that, you know, I wanted to go to vet school, but I just wasn't committed to doing 8 more years of school.
That's
so
a lot of school.
I saw that I had a lot of the backgrounds for research. So I looked into research, and here we are, 9 years later.
So just because a student sitting in chemistry right now might not think this is their career path, they should keep in mind that there are options.
Yes, things will change. You may have a teacher that's amazing with explaining the material, and you'll latch right onto it.
Wonderful. That's a good thing for everyone to remember.
Yes.
So thank you so much for joining us today.
You're welcome. Thanks for having me.
This unit has been filled with new ideas related to reaction rate, as explained by collision theory. You have a good handle on the types of factors that can speed up or slow down reactions, such as temperature, motion, and catalysts. You also now understand kinetic molecular theory and the ideal gas law, and how they explain the unusual behavior of gases. Finally, you applied your chemistry expertise to an engineering design challenge, testing your ideas for a new environmentally friendly airbag. I want to once again thank Lea Merriwether of the Georgia Aquarium for demonstrating for us some of the real-world applications of the concepts we covered in this unit. If you'd like some additional practice with gas law calculations, please check out our Closer Look video on that topic. It's in the Chemistry Matters Toolkit for Unit 9. When you're done, I'll be waiting for you at the top of our next Chemistry Matters unit, Unit 10, Chemical Equilibrium.